In this video, we're going to go over virtual threads within Java. Virtual threads were introduced in JDK 19 as a preview feature. They were updated slightly in JDK 20, and then they were refined again in JDK 21, and they are a full feature now in the language. A virtual thread is a lightweight alternative to what we normally refer to as a thread within Java, which is now what's called a platform thread. A platform thread is defined as a thread that has a thin wrapper around OS threads. So basically, every time that you kick off a new thread in Java, you kick off a new thread within the operating system, at least until virtual threads came along. These were highly inspired from Go routines within the Go programming language, which allow for massive scalability of concurrent tasks without having to bundle everything as operating system threads. If you want to do some of your own reading on virtual threads, I highly recommend that you check out JEP444 right here. This is a really good overview of the feature. And it summarizes motivation as well as what the language designers were trying to address with this update, as well as what they were trying to not address. So to touch on a few of the things listed here, it says that virtual threads are lightweight threads to dramatically reduce the effort of writing, maintaining, and observing high throughput concurrent applications. Wow, okay, so that's a mouthful. So really what that means is when you want to have a really high performing system, and concurrency is part of that system, and you have a lot of throughput to get through, then a virtual thread might be a better alternative compared to a platform thread. The biggest thing to focus on in that last sentence is high throughput. It does not say faster, it does not say lower latency, it says higher throughput. That is the big thing to keep in mind with a virtual thread versus a platform thread. Basically, with a virtual thread, you have more opportunities to potentially parallelize more concurrent actions. What you don't get is faster execution time. You get more effective use of the CPU, and I'll get into what that means here in a little bit. So I think that's enough theoretical talk. Let's get into some code, and I'm going to show you the nuts and bolts of how you use a virtual thread. So I want you to picture that you have a server. This server services all sorts of different concurrent requests. And how it does that is each time that a request comes in, it has a new thread that handles the request and then handles the response and goes through the entire process. This is a little different from the asynchronous workflow that might be in some other applications, but that's a separate discussion. And for now, each of these requests are just going to be that the thread has to sleep for a second. So I'm going to assume that our server gets hit with 1,000 of these at more or less the same time, and I'm going to time how long it would take using the old thread model. All right, so what this code is doing is it looks at the time that we start, the time that we end, and then we have this executor service, which has 1,000 different tasks that get submitted to it. And this is a cache thread pool, meaning that this is going to use platform threads or AKA operating system resources directly. So this is going to allocate 1,000 different OS threads. All right, so this is an ISO 8601 timestamp right here. So this is saying period with time 1.212 seconds. So 1.213 seconds is what you can assume that is. Another thing with Java is it does take a little bit of time for Java to warm up. So if I were to rerun this a few times, I might have a few different numbers, but the general idea is this takes a little over a second to run. So not too bad. I'm able to allocate about 1,000 different OS threads within a reasonable amount of time because each thread is waiting for a second. Okay, so what happens if I change this to a new fixed thread pool and I do 1,000 OS threads? The difference here is that I'm creating all my threads in this first line right here, rather than creating each thread when I make a new callable here. And we can see the behavior is pretty similar here, 1.176 seconds. Okay, so that is with platform threads. Now, let's say I want to change this to the new virtual threads. All I have to do is use a new static method, which is new virtual thread per task executor. So this acts similar to the first one where I don't have a thread pool. I basically create the virtual threads as I need them here whenever I submit new tasks to my executor. And running this, we can see that our time is slightly faster, but we're talking 100 milliseconds, 150 milliseconds. That's not all that significant. Let's go ahead and scale up our application now. Our client, instead of wanting 1,000 requests simultaneously, wants 100,000. So all I'm going to do is I'm just going to change that one little number in my code, and I'm going to go ahead and run it again. All right, and for virtual threads, I get 5 seconds, which means that it took a good bit longer in order to create those 100,000 virtual threads, but I was still able to do all of that and run them all with some level of concurrency. So not too bad. Let's try the others. This is going to be OS threads now, so I have to create 100,000 OS threads. Let's see how well this performs. All right, after waiting a little while, I can see that the performance is pretty different. So to create 100,000 OS threads, now it takes me 21.5 seconds in order to do that. And again, the reason is because OS threads are heavy. It takes a lot of operating system resources to create an OS thread. A virtual thread does not tie directly to an OS thread. A virtual thread can run underneath an OS thread. So you could have 2 or 3 or 20 virtual threads that all technically point to a single OS thread, but your Java code is none the wiser. You can write your code as if it still needs to be concurrent, even though it looks like to the operating system you only have a couple of OS threads. But the problem gets worse. A lot of people don't use the new cache thread pool. They use a new fixed size thread pool. So I want to do a new fixed thread pool of the same size, 100,000. So instead of being able to use a cache thread pool and have the operating system tell me when I need to wait for more OS threads to be created, I'm asking the OS, I want you to make 100,000 threads immediately before I try to submit any tasks. Let's see how long it takes us to do that. All right, so I had to kill my program because after about a minute, my system started being really, really sluggish and I started worrying if like my OS was gonna crash. So, not good. Imagine if your server starts really locking up when a whole bunch of requests start coming in. That's not a good thing. Now, a really important point here is that virtual threads are not faster than operating system threads. They allow more throughput potentially, meaning that if I have these active waits or if I've got like an IO operation and the CPU doesn't need to be doing anything, or let's say that it's waiting on something, it can do different instructions instead. That doesn't mean that you should always assume that a virtual thread is going to have significantly better performance. And while a virtual thread is generally a pretty good option for a lot of situations where you need to scale, you're not always going to see a massive speed improvement like I just showed here. It's one of those things where you should profile it and see what you see. So now let's dive a little bit deeper into virtual threads. So the first thing is, how do you know if the current thread that is running is a virtual thread or not? Well, the first thing I would ask you is, in your Java code, why would you really care? You shouldn't most of the time, but if you did, the way that you can tell is you can use the thread current thread is virtual method right here. And this returns a Boolean indicating whether the current thread is virtual or not. So let's go ahead and see if the main thread is a virtual thread. Do you think that this thread is an OS thread or a virtual thread? All right, and as expected, the launcher, when it launches your Java code, is still launching an OS thread, meaning that your Java process has at least one OS thread associated with it, which it would have to, because that's how the CPU knows to execute your logic, and then it's Java under the hood that can create virtual threads from that. So let's kick off a virtual thread this time and check the Boolean. So you can do that via thread.startVirtualThread and give it a runnable. So I'm going to use a lambda, and I'm going to say the same thing up here. So let's ask the thread that we just got kicked off, claiming that it is a virtual thread, and make sure that the JVM agrees with us. Interesting. So we still only printed out our main thread. So what we're probably going to have to do is we're probably going to have to wait for the thread here to join, and then let's just throw in a generic throws clause in here. So let's try it again, now that the main thread is going to wait for the virtual thread to join. All right, much better. And now we get the false and true as expected. So the virtual thread is correctly saying that it is virtual, whereas the main thread that comes up when the launcher launches our program is still an OS thread. So another way that you can make a virtual thread is you can use thread.ofvirtual rather than a platform. And then let's give it a name of my thread. And then let's assign this to a local variable. We don't need that last part there. And then we can create a runnable, which is going to be a lambda expression. And we'll just say hello within this thread. And then I want to rename this to thread builder. And then if we do a thread builder.start submitting our runnable, we can then assign that to the thread object. So there's our thread. So now we can do thread.getName, priority, all the normal things we would. Quick aside on priority. Virtual threads currently are normal priority. There is no way that you can set the priority of a virtual thread because OS threads have a certain priority associated with them, and the priority you give the JVM is a hint as far as how they should be prioritized to the OS. Currently, there is no way to do that with a virtual thread. I think that's something that would be a good addition in a future version of the language. So, anyway, you could do other things with a thread if you wanted to, such as joining it. And this will look similar to the code we had earlier, except this code is using the builder pattern, which has some advantages depending on how you're structuring your code. So a couple best practices and warnings I want to leave you with virtual threads. But first of all, a virtual thread is very lightweight. When you normally have to be careful about making a whole bunch of different threads, or you're worried about how many operating system resources you might use when you create a new thread, not nearly as much of a concern with a virtual thread. You could create a million virtual threads a whole lot easier than a million platform threads. And if you have limited hardware resources, a virtual thread is going to be your strong preference of what you should be using. Virtual threads solve the problem of throughput, not latency. What I mean by that is a virtual thread is not faster than an OS thread. In fact, it can be slower depending on any extra overhead that a virtual thread might incur that a closer to native OS thread may not have to deal with. But on the other hand, because the JVM has more insight into what your virtual thread is doing, it can control it much more and do more good things for you in the cases where that's what you're looking for, which 9 times out of 10 or more, you're probably looking for the JVM to help you out. So think of it this way. If an OS thread takes 50 milliseconds to do something when there's no resource contention, a virtual thread is going to take 50 milliseconds or more to do the same thing. But when you have 10 different OS threads that are all competing for resources and the OS has to do a lot of context switching versus if you can have 2 OS threads that each have 5 virtual threads, then each of those 5 virtual threads might be able to service something faster than the 10 OS threads. Thus, your throughput is potentially better, but it doesn't address any latency problems. The third thing is you should think really hard about if you need to pool a virtual thread. I would argue that you should rarely, if ever, use thread pools when you're dealing with virtual threads. Because the whole point of a thread pool is to conserve resources. With a virtual thread, you really don't need to conserve very many resources, whereas with OS threads, you have a lot more to worry about as far as overhead on the OS. So a lot of programming patterns around thread pools rely on the ability of the program to selectively use threads when certain resources need to be constrained. It's a pretty big programming shift, but I think a lot of programs are going to start shifting toward virtual threads that kick off a new thread whenever a task needs to be run. That doesn't mean that the old way of programming is done and the new way is far superior, but what I would highly recommend not doing is blindly changing your OS threads to virtual threads in every situation, including these thread pools that you may have implemented, because that's going to be less efficient than just using an OS thread. If the goal of your thread pool is, instead of resource conservation, concurrent modification protection, I would really consider doing something like a semaphore instead, because a semaphore has built-in constructs to make sure that only a certain number of resources can access something. whereas a thread pool comes with a lot of other considerations. And the last thing I'll leave you with is be careful with pinning and thread local. Pinning is when you have a virtual thread who has acquired a monitor, such as entering a synchronized block and not having exited yet, and there's a blocking operation that takes too long. In that case, what happens is in the current version of the JVM, the virtual thread holds up its resources as well as the OS thread that it has attached to it. And that is less than ideal. So what I highly recommend is when you're dealing with virtual threads, just like you would with an OS thread, make sure you're careful on what all you really have to synchronize. Only synchronize the really important stuff that doesn't take very long to execute. And the other one's thread local, which you can think of as a customization of object reference properties that are thread dependent, because a thread local reference is going to be specific to the thread in mind. That whole concept works with virtual thread, but the whole basis for thread local is again to conserve resources, kind of like item number 3, where you are pooling threads. If you're still worried about conserving resources in the case of virtual thread, you need to be careful that you understand what virtual threads are used for. They're used for highly scalable operations, and when you have a million virtual threads getting kicked off, and you need to copy all these different object references of something super expensive when you previously had a thread pool working with your thread local object reference, you may be doing something that you don't really want to. It might be not be as memory efficient as you want. So be careful about that. I think what we're going to find is that as virtual threads start getting used more, folks are going to figure out more and more best practices with using these versus platform threads. And that was a look at Java virtual threads as of JDK 21. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please do smash that like button. I'd really appreciate it. If you want to review some Java concurrency principles, check out some of my previous videos on concurrency. I cover various things from semaphores to synchronized to atomic to volatile, you name it. And if you have any video requests in the future on this topic, let me know in the comments below. Thanks again for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.